Hi there, and welcome back, friends of a thoughtful gaming experience. I'm your host, Emmanuel Ken. We're going to proceed with our Let's Play and explore Torment Tides of Numenera with our glaive. So, we've stopped somewhat suddenly last time. Why did I do that? Because I was a bit annoyed that I couldn't recover my points. So I've been walking around the city a little bit just to find if you can somewhere recover these points. And I've found a place which is thankfully nearby. So if you're playing as well, you will find this very helpful. It's near to a garden-like, park-like institution, I don't know, structure, would you say that? It's near that that bar you see there, on the big picture, but we'll just go directly there, and then make use of all the points we've gotten. So there, tranquility. As you enter the hostel, a woman as tall and graceful as a willow steps forward to greet you. She bows, then looks down at you with warm gold-flecked eyes. Welcome, she says, to Tranquility's Rest. What a nice name. I'd totally sleep there. I am the proprietress, Tranquility. Are you looking for a place to take your ease? As she speaks, a sense of delicious calm comes over you, and you find yourself wanting to agree with her. There's nothing you'd like better right now than the peace and solitude of a quiet room. Forgive me for asking, but are you human? She laughs melodiously. No need for apologies, given my height. It's a natural question. I'm indeed human, a human mutant, and fortunate to live in Sager's Cliffs where that is not a crime. There are very few places in this world where someone like me would even be allowed to clean a hostel, let alone own one. Tell me about Tranquility's Rest. She smiles. It's the most peaceful inn in Sager's Cliffs, with the most beautiful views. All rooms face out, so that the bustle of the caravanserai is invisible and inaudible. All you see is sky and sea, and the roofs of the city far below you, and all you hear is the breeze. I am the sole owner, and I've been offering solitude, security, and discretion for travelers for 20 years. You will never have as sound a night's sleep as you will when you stay here. Yeah, well then, let's sleep here. Tranquility smiles. I'm so pleased, and I'm sure you will be most comfortable. Price is 2 shins per person, which is not much, so give her the money and rest. Thank you, my friend. Rest well. And we're resting. And we have our points back. Tiber catches your sleeve. Just a reminder, lad, before we start on the day. Riss will be dead by the day after tomorrow if we don't do anything to save him. Alright, then let's concentrate on the task, shall we? Oh, we'll have to go back here, I guess. Then back to Circus Minor. Then go to Government Square and get that whatever thing we'll need. And you can flank enemies here. So, it seems like we won't have time for this Finzin guy. go straight on to our task to save the companion of our mighty Tibber. We would probably get this lord to help if we told him about the Stichers. But come on, that creature is pitiful. We won't give that poor creature to the rage or the political instrumentalism of the Lord. Even if we agree to the intentions of the Lord, we won't help him in that case, because the Stichus is clearly harmless. So, let's look on the map. We need to go up here. We need to proceed here, then go there. Alright. A crier, a child. And a strange flying octopus. I haven't looked at that thing before. I haven't talked to this person before. Maybe Beleazar can help us. This thin, fidgeting Aeon priest shoots furtive sidelong glances at the creature in the nearby cage while humming a nonchalant tune. When he sees that you're watching him, he flinches. Over the course of a few frantic breaths, shock becomes embarrassed anger. And he opens his mouth to shout at you. What? Yes? What is it? What is so goddamn fascinating about me that you feel the need to stare? What do you know about the creature over there? What? Balazar says, jumping. Then he takes a breath and struggles to sound off it. It's a Nuchtameron, a biomechanical creature, an information gatherer, in fact. They roam ancient ruins, looking for hidden mysteries, valuable secrets. He seems to calm down as he warms to the topic. They're dangerous, though. You can only speak to them at night. During daylight, they'll attack without provocation. A living repository of knowledge, Calistig murmurs, watching the creature. I wonder what places it has seen. What it knows. Eleazar's eyes narrow suspiciously. You're planning something, aren't you? Frowning at your words, Beleazar turns to regard you. Then he notices your tattoo, and his eyes go wide. I've heard of people like you. What are you doing? No, never mind. You just ask me. I mean, he trails off and seems to reach a decision. I'm working on something dangerous, and it would be an honor if you could lend your assistance. I have a device, he says in a hoarse whisper that can probably be heard from meters away. Someone can get close enough to affix it to the creature's cage, it will activate and teleport the Nuchtameron to the reef of fallen worlds. He snickers and rubs his hand together. And then... And then you'll study it? In a manner of speaking... Nuchtamerons gather data from the ruins they visit. Eleazar says, his eyes shining hungrily. It's a biomechanical organism, which means that the data must be stored in one of its organs. I want you to teleport the creature out of its cage, kill it, and bring me the memory organ. How does that device work? I'm not sure, Beleazar admits, mouth twisting. My former colleague found it within the rusted casing of a war machine. I say former, because when he activated it, he disappeared. We found his remains spread across the reef, as if he was hurled at the ground with great force. He looks briefly nauseous at the memory. That seems familiar to me. Now you might be thinking the Nuchtameron will perish in the same manner, and it might. But I wouldn't count on it. The creature can float. This sounds too easy. I just walk up, plant the device in the creature's cage and activate it. If it were that easy, I would do it, Belisar says, but the creature's captors protect its cage. And well, they've already caught me once, but they won't be watching for you. Belisar rubs the back of his hand across his mouth. Tell them you wish to see the beast and plant the device when they're not watching. And if you get caught, don't tell them I sent you. He lowers his voice to a horrified whisper. When they said they'd lodge a complaint with the order. They said they'd lodge a complaint. Tell me how to get past the guards again. Ask to see the Nyctemeron and plant the device when they're not looking. Again, if they catch you, I was not involved. Want me to kill it for its brain? Isn't that murder? Please, Belisar says, rolling his eyes so hard you're surprised you can't hear them squeaking in their sockets. It's a machine. It's not alive. If it makes you feel better, tell yourself you're deactivating a faulty device that will defend itself with lethal force. Alright, give me the device and I'll see what I can do. I won't, but here it is, he says, handing it over and nervously licking his lips. Be very, very careful. I don't have another one. Oh, thank you for that teleporting thing. Now we're off. Now let's try the plan. Tibia's plan again. Additional characters, features and even companions will be made available in the full release. That's good to know. So, this guy sold the badges, I guess. Welcome back, sir. It is an honor to serve you again. What can I do for you? Wait until Sangolin isn't looking and try to steal the badge from the mannequin. Challenging. We'll have to try that. Critical success. Seeing what you're up to, Tiber distracts Sangolin by asking him about a beautiful waistcoat. But they are both turned away from you, you pluck the badge of the mannequin. Sangolin turns back to you just as you hide it. He suspects nothing. Well, it's for a good cause. To help someone not get killed. Welcome back, sir. It is an honor to serve you again. What can I do for you? Farewell. No. We have the badge. And I guess this is the office. A smooth metal door has no apparent handle or hinge. Entry must be controlled from the inside. Let's talk to this guy. Sigan. Oh, this woman. This woman is dressed much like the levies who flank her, but unlike them, her expression is sober and alert. Her hair is cut short, the corners of her eyes wrinkled with crow's feet. A little swarm of mechanical drones circles around her. Buzzing messages in her ears, she whispers, replies in return, and every so often one of them whisks away, disappearing into the city. What is it, citizen? She pauses, eyes darting to your tattoo. And your face? No, you're the one they call Adan. I heard you were in the city. Sense a sudden wariness in her. It's been 10 years since your last visit. I was too young to know of you then, but the drones remember. What do they remember about me? On cue, two of her attendant drones dip close to her ear, emitting a stream of raspy noise. It might be some sort of language. You kept to your own affairs, but everywhere you went, the city held its breath. People deferred to you, even the ones with power and influence. You look the same as you do now, exactly the same. I want to know why, and if you don't mind telling me, I want to know what you're doing in Sagas now. Oh, I'm trying to escape a creature that's hunting me. Smoking tendrils, grasping talons, a towering, nebulous shape. She sees the look on your face and nods. I've seen it, but only through the eyes of a drone. Not long ago, it killed a man in the streets. A man with the same mark you bear. If anyone else knew, there'd be panic, even if it's only hunting. People like you. I haven't told anyone, not even the council. Another drone swoops past you, stopping just short of the woman's head. It unleashes a series of raspy buzzes and squawks. She whispers something to it, then glances back in your direction. What was it you wanted? What were you? Who are you first? Sigyn, captain of levies. I'm not a levy myself, but I command them. What are levies? Soldiers, she gestures at the two burly smiling men to her left and right. They look like identical twins, soldiers in the council's service. They keep order in the city. Her lips purse briefly, but she continues. Every citizen is required to raise a levy for the city's defense. The prize is a year of their lives. How are they raised? Anyone who lives in the city can become a citizen at 16 years of age. Or the equivalent if they're not human. There's only one requirement. They step into a machine at the Order of Truth, and it takes away a year of the citizen's life. Uses that year to create a levy. She lowers her voice, seemingly for the benefit of the levies standing beside her. That 1 year is all a levy gets. When it's over, they die. They keep every district safe? No, she frowns. Underbelly lives under its own law. Cliff's Edge lives under no laws at all. They seem awfully happy, though. A smile and a pleasant demeanor could have 100 explanations, yet this whole city is fooled by them. She shakes her head. I know the levies better than anyone, so the truth is plain to me. Though I'd be lying if I claimed to truly understand them. Are you sure the levies aren't happy? They only seem so. Her face is flat, unreadable. They are not. Why don't you send any levies to Cliff's Edge? A lot of homes have been collapsing, and the city hasn't been able to help. The tone is cautiously neutral. The council believes that the presence of levies could incite them to violence. All right. If the levies don't keep order in Underbelly, then who does? A man called Falzum. Her expression is unreadable. I don't know anything about him. I've got other questions. Go on then. What were you saying? Or more about the levies? Yeah, that's... no. Other questions. What were you saying to those drones? They carry my orders to levies all over the city. And they bring reports from the levies back to me. She reaches out a hand and one of the drones buzzes something unintelligible. A few years ago, the Aeon priests found them buried underground. Brought them back to life. I learned their language, so our conversations are safe from prying ears. What's in the building behind you? She frowns. I know you lived here for a time. How is it that you don't recognize the seat of government? To tell the truth, I've lost my memory. You've lost more than that. I've seen images of you through the eyes of the drones. 10 years ago, you moved differently, carried yourself like a king in the steadfast. You've lost your soul, or gained one. Don't mean to be harsh, she gives you a faint smile. Thank you for being honest with me. She waves a hand at the doors behind her. The council meets in there. A representative from every slave family and from some of the guilds, depending upon who's in favor. Hardly anyone goes in through the doors, though. They're just a formality. Most people have other ways of getting inside and out. Never seen a building like this before. What is it? They say it's a ship built by the ancients to sail the void between worlds. Now the crag grips it tight, like an old husband holds his wife, and it will never sail free again. Farewell. The smooth metal door has no apparent handle, alright. Let's talk to the council clerk. Behind a lectern, a four-eyed, hairless mutant processes paper with balletic grace. He's endlessly snapping the elegant fingers of his left hand, and each time the air twists and shimmers. Either disgorging a document to be processed or accepting one that he's completed with his ink-stained right hand. Each of his eyes regards a distinct object, portals that are opening, preambles and recitals that must be reviewed, his own addenda that must be flawless. One eye twitches in your direction. Exaggerated scorn twists his mouth, and though his eyes remain fixed on your face, he gives no verbal acknowledgement. The closest he comes is a faint sigh. At last, after shunting half dozen more documents to some distant cubby, he condescends to speak. You must wait, of course, until council matters conclude. His quarter gaze leaves you, his face returns to its former equanimity, and he continues his work, which shows no evidence of slacking, let alone concluding. All right. I guess this will be say first farewell to him. The clerk gives no acknowledgement that he heard and merely continues with his work. This must be the way to save his companion. And I think this is good to us to do next time, because we've had so much conversation right now, and we've also found a place where we can rest finally. So next time we'll try to free Tibber's companion. So this concludes our session of Thoughtful Gaming then. Thank you for watching. If you like the videos, then I'm happy. And I wish you happy gaming. And see you in the next episode. This is Immanuel Can, signing out.